Hello everyone, welcome to AKS, myself Rachna. In this session, we are going to see the different classical dance forms of India. So in order to understand the classical dances here, we need to understand three basic aspects of the classical dances in India. The first one being the Natya, the second one is called the Nitya, third one is Nrita. This Natya, it is the dramatical element of the dance where the dancer performs the drama within this dance. Coming to the second one, that is Nritya, it is nothing but the expressional form of dance. Now this usually it is performed in order to convey the theme or idea of the dance. So with the expression, the dancer here tries to convey the theme or the idea of the dance. Coming to the third one called as Nrita, here it involves only pure dance form where you cannot express neither the expressions nor something kind of dramatical elements, but only pure dance form you can see in the Nrita, where the body movements do not convey any kind of meaning, neither the mood. So one needs to remember these three aspects when we are talking about the classical dances of India, where we will try to know in this each classical dance which element dominates. Sometimes in some dances like Kathak, you will see it is dominated by the Natya, where it involves both dance and drama, and whereas in few dances you will see it is mostly dominated by the pure dance or the Nrita. Now, in order to understand the classical dances in more brief, they have classified these classical dances into two forms called as Tandava and the Lasya. Tandava, here once we hear this word, usually the Shivji comes to our mind, right? In the same way, this Tandava is mostly, it is very bold kind of dance form, and it is mostly masculine dance form. Whereas Lasya actually tries to show very feminine character of the dance, and it is basically very soft. So in India, we get to see we have 8 classical dances. The classical dances are the one which are being recognized by the Sangeet Natak Academy, or what we call it as National Academy for Performing Arts. So the basic difference between the classical dances and the folk dances is that in classical dances, they have certain strict rules and regulations that needs to be followed. And these rules and regulations are continuously guided by the Sangeet Natak Academy. Although in the folk dances also we have some kind of regulation, but yet they are not very strictly followed, right? So only this 8 classical dances, they follow the rules and regulations very strictly, and they are being emphasized by the Sangeet Natak Academy. So we have 8 classical dance forms which are recognized by the Sangeet Natak Academy. So in order to appreciate this 8 classical dances, one needs to remember the 3 words that we have used here, right? So if you go through this keyword some twice or thrice, you will be able to appreciate the differences, which will make our understanding of this 8 classical dances in much ease. Coming to the first dance form, it is called as Bharatanatyam, which has originated in the state of Tamil Nadu. This dance form is considered to be the most oldest dance form of India, because we hear about the mention about this dance form in the Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra, a book written on the traditional dance forms. So in this Natya Shastra, Bharat Muni has mentioned about the Bharatanatyam. So this Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra provides us the evidence of the existence of Bharatanatyam. Not only that, another author also has mentioned about the Bharatanatyam. Here the author name is Nandi Keshava, and in his book Abhinaya Dharpana, he has mentioned about the Bharatanatyam's the study of technique as well as the grammar of the body movements that are used in the Bharatanatyam. So this both books provide us the examples of the Bharatanatyam, which was existing right from the very old age. Not only that, in this books that we get an evidence of the Bharatanatyam, but we also, if you can glance over the Chidambaram temple, this temple wall carvings display all the 108 karanas from the Natya Shastra, which was written by the Bharat Muni. And this postures, if you can see properly, form the foundation for the Bharatanatyam. So all these are evidences in order to tell about the existence of the Bharatanatyam. This Bharatanatyam dance form, it is also called as Ekharya. Ekharya here means only one dancer will take many roles in a single performance. That is why Ek here means one. That is why the Bharatanatyam here, it is also called as Ekharya. And the beauty of this Bharatanatyam is that in 19th century, under the Tanjore king named as Raja Sharovji, is when this Bharatanatyam has got its repertoire. Here, repertoire here means a set of rules and regulations that needs to be followed in the dance form. But not only that, if you see, this style of the repertoire and all was kept alive because of the Devadasis. This we know about the Devadasis are nothing but the young girls who are given as gifts to the temple and who are married to the gods. So this Devadasis performed music and dance as an offering to the gods in the temple courtyards. And some of the renowned performers and gurus, if we see of the early century, they all belong to the Devadasi system. Example, even the Balaswara Saraswati, who comes from the Devadasi families. So they are the one who led this tradition to actually come to this generation. As we have seen the three aspects that are involved in each classical form, right? So this Bharatanatyam, it is solo, it is performed solo, that's why it is called as Ekharya, and it shows the Lasya form of dance. Coming to the repertoire of the Bharatanatyam, repertoire here means whole body of items which are usually performed in any dance form. So the repertoire of Bharatanatyam is very composed and elaborate when compared to the other dance forms of India. So here within the repertoire of Bharatanatyam, first it starts with the Alari Puvu. The meaning of Alari Puvu is to adorn with flowers. It usually starts with the invocation of a song, and it is an abstract piece combining a pure dance form. If you remember, pure dance form here we call it as Nrita, right? So here a dancer actually starts with the Alari Puvu, that means adornation with the flowers, and she performs the pure dance along with the recitation of sound syllables. Followed by Alari Puvu is another piece called as Jatishwaram. Here Jatishwaram is also again the Nrita form, which involves the pure dance piece, which is usually performed to the musical notes of any raga of the Carnatic music. And here it is what Jatishwaram forms the basis of training in the Bharatanatyam dance. And here we do not see any kind of words or sahityam in the Jatishwaram. It just involves the pure dance, right? Next, Jatishwaram here, it is followed by the Shabdam. And Shabdam here is an expressional form of the dance form of Bharatanatyam here. And because if we see, usually it is a solo woman who tries to perform this Bharatanatyam. So she heavily leans on the Abhinaya. Here you can see Angika Abhinaya, Shingara Rasa or Karuna Rasa, right? So these are all the expressions which are just shown by the dancer. And this expression is what we call it as Abhinaya, right? Or a mime, this is like a dance drama. That's why because the dancer here is also trying to express the theme of the dance, we call the Shabdam, it heavily relies on the nritya. Kritya, which is the expressional form. This Shabdam is again followed by the Varnam, and this Varnam is the most important composition of the Bharatanatyam. Here we get to see both Nritya, that is expressions, as well as the Rita, which is a pure dance form. And the dancer here tries to perform a very complicated but yet very well graded rhythmic patterns, especially on two speeds she will be able to manage. So this shows how she is trying to control the rhythm, and then she goes on to depict the variety of abhinayas, right? So that is why this Varnam is called as one of the most beautiful compositions in all the Indian dances. So after this complex set of speed and the works the particular dancer does, now she goes on with the performance in order to perform the different abhinayas. So abhinaya here means the one who is trying to express the variety of moods. Maybe it can be like bhava expression or the rasa, and usually those bhavas she tries to express with the text that is being read on the background of the music. And the common pieces of this abhinaya are the kirtanam. Here kirtanam, the text becomes very important. And whereas coming to the another abhinaya, which is called as kritis, and here in kritis music becomes important. But yet both are very very devotional in character, and they try to represent the devotional aspect. Coming to the third number of abhinaya, that is padamas, and the fourth one is called the javali, and this usually are on the theme of love, and often they are to the divine, right? So there are the five aspects that we have seen in the repertoire of the Bharatanatyam. First we will see how they try to adorn the god with the flowers, that is called as alari puvu. You can remember it as a Telugu word like puvu, alari puvu. It starts with the flowers and it involves only pure dance form. It is followed by the Jatiswaram. You can remember it because there is Rameshwaram in the Tamil Nadu, right? So this Jatiswaram, again in Jatiswaram, it involves only pure dance form and it does not have any kind of words. Then it is followed by the Shabdam. In Shabdanam, the dancer tries to show the expressional form, or she also tries to heavily rely on the abhinayas. So it involves the Nritya form, and it is followed by the Varnam, which is the most important and the beautiful aspect of the Bharatanatyam. And here it involves both Nritya, she tries to express this, as well as she tries to perform the dance with a well-graded steps with two speeds. Then it is followed by the number of abhinayas. In abhinayas we see four kind of abhinayas. The first one being the kirtanam, where the text she tries to tell the text. In kirtis usually it is music, and both are related to the devotional. Coming to the third abhinaya and the fourth one, called as padmas and the javali, both are related to the love, as well as mostly the love to the divine. Coming to the sixth repertoire of the Bharatanatyam, it is called as Tilana. And here in Tilana, because she is just coming to the end, there you can see the vibrant dance form. And this word Tilana, somewhere it actually reminds us of Tarana, right? And absolutely, as it is reminding of this word Tarana, this Tilana has its origin in the Tarana of the Hindustani classical music. So the final of the piece is a series of well-graded designed rhythmic lines by reaching the climax. So here the climax or the performance comes to an end with the Mangalam, which means invoking the blessings of the gods, right? So we have seen how it actually starts with the adorning of flowers, and then it ends with the Mangalam by invoking the blessings of the god. Coming to the orchestra, which usually accompanies the Bharatanatyam, it consists of a vocalist, right, as well as the mridangam player, violinist, veena player, and a flutist, as well as a cymbal player. We will just see in our musical classes about what are this kind of instruments. As of now, just try to remember this musical instruments. Coming to the important personalities which have really gained a lot of fame by performing the Bharatanatyam involves the Rukmini Devi Arundel, Bala Saraswati, Mrunalini Sarabhai, Yamini Krishnamurti and Sonal Mansingh. Another important aspect of Bharatanatyam is that it is somewhat similar or compared to the Mohiniyattam of Kerala. Coming to the next important dance form called as Kuchipudi, which belongs to the state of Andhra Pradesh. This name Kuchipudi is derived from a village in the Krishna district of Andhra Pradesh. Tirtha Narayana and his student Siddhendra Yogi have been credited for developing a very important piece of repertoire of the Kuchipudi called as Bhama Kalapam. It is said there is some kind of mythology attached to it. They say that this Siddhendra Yogi had a dream in which Lord Krishna has asked him to compose a dance drama based on the myth of bringing Parijata flower. Hope you all know about the Parijata flower, which is considered to be a favorite flower of Lord Krishna. So here it is said that the Lord Krishna has appeared in the dreams of Siddhendra Yogi and asked him to compose a dance drama in a myth of bringing this Parijata flower for the Satyabhama, who was the most favorite queen of Krishna. So in compliance with this command, Siddhendra Yogi has composed this Bhama Kalapam, which is still now considered to be the most important piece of the repertoire in the Kuchipudi. And this Bhama Kalapam has become such a famous one that during that time, the Nawab of Golconda called as Abdul Hasan Tanisha issued a copper plate in 1675. Granting the village from where it has derived the name called as Kuchipudi as a agraharam to the families of Brahmins who were trying to pursue this art of dance drama called as Kuchipudi. So that time, if we see, usually this dance form was only performed by the Brahmin boys, but as of today even the single woman performed the Kuchipudi. It is said it is Lakshmi Narayana Shastri who introduced the new elements into the Kuchipudi, including the solo dancing as well as training of female dancers into this dance style. So important things to remember here is about the Tirtha Narayana and his student Siddhendra Yogi, who composed the Bhama Kalapam, and which is an important piece of repertoire. We have seen in the previous dance form what do they mean by repertoire, and earlier it was done only by the Brahmin boys, but now even the solo women perform it. And the performance of solo women or bringing such type of new elements is credited to the Lakshmi Narayan Shastri. Coming to the repertoire of the Kuchipudi, as we have also seen the repertoire of the Bharatanatyam, right? In the same way, here in the Kuchipudi also we have a repertoire. And as we have seen in the Bharatanatyam, in the last we shall see the comparison so that it will help you in better remembrance, right? So we in the Bharatanatyam, we have started with the Alari Puvu, right? So this Alari Puvu, nothing but the invocation number, usually Alari Puvu, which was starting with the flowers, right? In the same way, in the Kuchipudi also, usually the Kuchipudi starts with the invocation of the Ganesha Vandana, but earlier it was only restricted to the Ganesha Vandana. But now even other gods are also invoked. Yet after the invocation of the God's blessings, they move to the next step called as Jatiswaram. This Jatiswaram was also similar to that of the Bharatanatyam, right? So here in Jatiswaram, they perform a pure dance form called as Nritta. Nritta, as we remember, it is nothing but the pure dance form, and it does not have any kind of narration or the dancing. Next, the Jatiswaram is followed by the Shabdam. And in Shabdam, it is the narrative form of the dance, so we can call it as a Nritta here. The most preferred one of the Shabdam in the Kuchipudi dance is a dasavatara. Next, the shabdam is here again followed by the kalpam, right? It is the representation of the natya, and many dancers here prefer the bhama kalpam, where they try to show the entry of Satyabhama from the traditional dance drama which was composed by the Siddhendra Yogi called as Bhama Kalpam, right? Then the Kalpam is again followed by the Abhinaya, which is based on the literature cum musical aspect. As we know, Abhinaya means expressions, so that is actually dealt with the Nritya form of dance. And in Abhinaya, we can expect Padam, Javali as well as the Shlokam. And finally comes the conclusion of the Kuchipudi called as Tarangam. So before we see the appreciate the importance of Tarangam in the Kuchipudi dance, if we can actually try to compare it with the Bharatanatyam, then we will be able to remember them, right? So in the invocatory part in Bharatanatyam, we have seen it was called as Alaripu, where the adornation of the flowers was going on. In Kuchipudi, usually they start this invocatory. We do not have any specific name like Alaripu, but it starts with the Ganesh Vandanam. But now they are also trying to invoke the other gods. In the same way as a Bharatanatyam, here also we see Jatishwaram, where they perform the pure dance form called as Nrita. Then it is followed by the Shabdam. Here also in the Bharatanatyam we see Shabdam, where they tries to give the expressional form called as Nitya. Then in the fourth part here itself, we have seen the Varanam in the Bharatanatyam. But such type of Varanam here, it is called as Kalpam, which is usually well-graded steps of Natya, and here it's the most famous one is the Bhama Kalpam. The fifth one is again same Abhinaya, where it involves number of expressions. Like here you can see Kirtanam, Kirti, Padams and Javalis, whereas in Abhinaya of Kuchipudi you can see Padam, Javali and Shlokam. And sixth one was the Tilana, and the last one was the Mangalam, whereas in Kuchipudi we have only six repertoires and it ends with Tarangam, right? So important thing to remember which differentiates them is, first, the invocation is same but it is called as Alaripu. Second and third steps are same. In the fourth step is also same, but here it is called as Varanam. In Kuchipudi it is called as Kalpam. Then the fifth step is again same, belonging to the Abhinaya. And here we have two extra steps called as Tilana and Mangalam. Whereas in Kuchipudi, we get to see only Tarangam, which is the conclusion part. So coming to the highlight of the Kuchipudi, the sixth and the final version, here it is called as Tarangam. In Tarangam, usually the dancer stands on the edge of the brass plate. And here she tries to balance the pot of water on her head and also with the lighted diyas. Here you can see the picture in order to know how she is trying to balance her body by using all these instruments. So the musical instruments used in the Kuchipudi, other than the Carnatic music here, it is followed by the Mridangam, violin or Veena, sometimes both are used, and also the cymbals. Coming to the next dance form, the only dance form of northeastern corner of India, called as the Manipuri. Because of the geographical location, especially if you see the map where exactly this Manipur is located, it shows that because of its seclusion, this region was able to retain the unique traditional culture. That's why we see that in Manipuri dance, it is not affected by any of the other dance form. It does not have any kind of resemblance with any dance form. But yet, if you see Manipuri dance, it is considered to be very oldest dance form. Even before the recorded history we have, it says that Manipuri's dance came into prominence even before we have a recorded history. Because if you see, in Manipuri dance, we get to see a lot of rituals and the traditional festivals. They say that Manipuri dance is something related to the Shiva and Parvati and other gods who were in when they were creating the universe, their actions actually culminated to form the Manipuri dance. Not only that, if you see the features of the Manipuri dance, this is mostly a purely religious dance, unlike other dances where we see some of the dance also includes love. But when it comes to Manipur dance, it is mostly devotional and it does not have any acts of love. The importance of Manipuri dance again is that it is Rabindranath Tagore who tried to popularize the Manipuri dance. If you look at the costumes of the Manipuri dance, here you can see they usually wear a very loose clothes, and unlike the other classical dancers, there is a strict no for the ankle belts in the Manipuri dance. And unlike the other dance forms also, who actually face the audience, that is considered to be very important. But in Manipuri dance, they do not watch the audience. Either well, they'll watch here, you can see in the picture, either they'll watch down or they'll watch up in order to show the devotion to the god. And unlike the other dances again, here foot should not be hit too hard to the ground. But if we compare with the Kuchipudi or the Bharatanatyam, here foot must be compulsorily hit onto the ground, but that is not the case with the Manipuri. The main theme of Manipuri dance is the Ras Leela, and how we got this Ras Leela, which has started, which got popularized in the 15th century, how it got attached to the dance form, which we feel would have started somewhere in the prehistoric times, right? So the origin of the Manipuri dance goes back to a festival called as Lai Haroba. This Lai Haroba is the earliest form of dance which forms the basis for the all the Manipuri dance that they are following here. The meaning of Lai Haroba here means merrymaking of the gods. So it was performed as a ceremonial offering of song and dance to the gods. So the principal performers here in Manipuri dance, we call them as Maibas and Maibis. Maibas are the priests and the Maibis means the priestess who try to reenact the theme of the creation of the world. Now, after the arrival of Vaishnavism, that is during the 15th century AD, a new component which is based on the episodes of Radha Krishna were added to the Manipuri dance. And that is where, after the coming of the Vaishnavism into the Manipuri dance, that is where we see the origin of the Ras Leela to come and collaborate with the Manipuri dance. This Manipuri dance, just like other classical dances, it also has a repertoire. And in this repertoire, in Manipuri dance, we find large one of them. But now here, let us talk about the most popular forms. The repertoire here consists of Ras, Sankirtana, as well as Tangta. Tangta was once asked in the UPSC prelims. And I think even they have once asked about the Sankirtana. So talking about this repertoire, about the Ras, this Ras dance has some five principles. And among this five principles, four of them are linked to the specific seasons, while the fifth one can be presented at any time of the year. And in Manipuri Ras, the main characters here are Radha, Krishna and Gopikas. Next, Sankirtan. Here you can get the word from where we have got the Sankirtan. We have been hearing about the Kirtana form, right? So this Kirtana form of congregation singing which accompanies the dance here is known as Sankirtana in Manipur. Here usually the male dancers play pung and kartal while dancing. If you see here pung cholam and here you can see kartal cholam, as depicted in the picture, there are mostly masculine aspect of the dance of Manipuri. Whereas if you can see, this cholams are all part of the Sankirtana tradition, whereas the pung and kartal cholams are performed at all the social and religious festivals. Coming to the third repertoire called as Tangta. Here Tangta, it is the male martial dancers of Manipur called as Tangta, and they have their origin in the days when these people were actually trying to survive in the wild. In order to protect themselves from the wild animals, that is when they started this martial kind of act into the Manipuri dance. So today the Manipuri has an evolved and a very sophisticated repertoire of martial dances. Here we see how the dancers are trying to use the swords, spears and the shields. So even the real fight scenes between the dancers show a very extensive training and the control of the body. So as we have seen, there are two forms of dances, right? We have talked about the Tandava, which is masculine, as well as the Lasya. So here in Manipuri, in the previous pictures, we have seen it was the women who were involved as well as men. As we see, men are mostly involved in the Tangta and the Sankirtana, whereas in the Ras form of repertoire, it was mostly related to the Radha, Krishna and Gopikas, right? That is why we see that Manipuri dance incorporates both Tandava as well as Lasya, and it ranges from vigorous masculine to the subdued and graceful feminine. And here, talking about the Abhinaya or the expressions of the Manipuri dance, they do not give very elaborate expressions and all, but they try to keep a very natural and a subtleness of the style when they are trying to express themselves. Coming to the musical instruments that are used in the Manipuri classical style of singing, this style of singing is called as Naat, and it is very different from, if we see most of the classical dancers, either they are using the Carnatic or the Hindustani music. But as it is away from the other type of classical dances, this Manipuri dance also uses a different kind of Indian music called as Naat. The main musical instrument is called as Pung, or it is also, Pung is nothing but a Manipur classical drum. And there are also many other kinds of drums which are used in this, called as Penna, a stringed instrument used in Lai Haruba as well as Penna singing. And as we have seen in the Kartal Cholam, right, these people use cymbals which are used in Sankirtana and Ras, and as well as flute is also accompanied in the vocal singing. Gita Govinda of Jayadeva's Ashtapadi is very popular, and they are usually sung and danced in the Manipuri with great religious fever. Now besides the Ras that we have seen as a repertoire, right, so there are also other Leelas. Each stage in one's life is celebrated with Sankirtana performance, like Upanyaya or Shraddha are all occasions when they will do this singing and dancing in Manipur. So the whole community participates as a song and dance form of daily life expressions. Coming to the next dance form, this dance form is from the state of Kerala, called as Mohiniyattam. Mohiniyattam, the real literal meaning of this Mohiniyattam is that we already know about the Mohini, which is, according to the Puranic story, that Lord Vishnu took on a guise as a Mohini in order to seduce the Asuras, both for churning of the ocean as well as the episode of slaying the Bhasmasura. In these two occasions, it was Vishnu who took the avatara of Mohini, and this Mohiniyattam is somewhere related to the same kind of Puranic story. And in Mohiniyattam, you can see how Vishnu has taken the form of a woman. That's why in this Mohiniyattam, you basically get to see the Lasya form of dance. And that is why you can see the delicate body movements as well as the subtle facial expressions are more feminine in nature, and therefore they are basically suited for the performance of women. And mostly it is the solo women who perform this Mohiniyattam. This Mohiniyattam, it is not very old as we have seen in the Bharatanatyam, right? Because we see the reference of Mohiniyattam from the text of Vyavarahamala, which was written in 1705 by Mala Magalai Narayana Nambupatri, and in the Goshayatra, which was written by Kunjan Nambiar. Here we need to remember the two things, that is Vyavarahamala, which was written by the Malamagalam Narayana Nambupatri, and the Goshayatra, which was written by the poet Kunjan Nambiar. This dance form is actually structured into the present classical format by the Travancore kings, called as Maharaja Kartika Tirunal and his successor Maharaja Swati Tirunal. Coming to the salient features of the Mohiniyattam dance, as it is mostly Lasya form of dance as we have seen, so it is characterized very gracefully, swaying body movements, and there will be no abrupt jerks or the sudden leaps. It belongs to the Lasya style as I told, so it is feminine, tender and graceful. And the movements here emphasized by the glides of up and down movements of toes, just like the waves of the sea or the swaying of coconut palm tree and the paddy fields. Because we know that they are really near to the sea or the western coast, and the coconut trees how and all they are familiar. In the same way here the dance form does not have, like, it will show kind of swinging just like how the coconut or the palm tree or the waves of a sea move. So the footwork in this Mohiniyattam is not very terraced, and it is very very soft kind of dance. And here they give very much importance to the hand gestures and the mukha abhinaya with subtle facial expressions. And the movements of this hand gestures are borrowed from the Nangyar Kuttu and the female folk dancers called as Kai Kotti Kali and Tiruvathakar Kali. So as the word is very important, artam, which means the dance, or the, you can see, talk it about the Natya form of dance. So that is the reason this Mohiniyattam lays emphasis on the acting, and here each actor tries to identify herself with the character and the sentiments which are existing in the composition, like Padamas, Padmavaranams, which give ample opportunity for the facial expressions. Coming to the hand gestures, they are basically 24 in number, and they are mostly adopted from the Hasta Lakshana Deepika. This is the same text which is followed by the Kathakali, which belongs to the same state of Kerala. And some of the hand gestures here also borrowed from the Natya Shastra, Abhinaya Darpan, as well as Balarama Bharatam. So here the gestures and the facial expressions are close to the natural and the realistic than the dramatic or the rigidly conventional forms that we see in the Kathakali or the Bharatanatyam. And talking about the repertoire of the Mohiniyattam, it includes, these words are little not very difficult because we have already talked about the Jatiswaram, we know about the Padam, Tilana, right? And here it includes Cholliketu, Jatiswaram, Padavaranam, and Padam, Tilana, and Shlokam. Besides this, there are also some kind of local recitals, which is not very important. But if we see, the important thing to remember here is that most of the composition here includes repertoire, which have been composed by the Swati Tirunal, who emphasizes on the Sahitya Bhava, that is literary content. Coming to the next important dance form called as Odissi, and it is on the eastern coast of our country. This dance form is considered to be the oldest surviving classical dance of India. And if you see, this dance form is basically based on the temple structures of the Sun Konark Temple of Odisha. And this dance form, unlike the Manipuri dance form, which was mostly devotional, this dance form includes both love and devotion, which are basically taken from the Gita Govinda of Jayadeva. And in Odissi dance, it includes both men and women together dance. And talking about the archaeological evidences to prove that this is one of the oldest surviving classical dance, we have examples of the caves which provide us the archaeological evidence of the Odissi dance. From the caves of Udaygiri and Kandagiri, which were excavated or built during the 2nd century BC. This dance form is also unique because it is where it shows a synthesis of Dharma or the faith of Jagannatha cult, which is very famous in the Puri district of Odisha. This dance form heavily relies on two people as the chief repositories of the dance. One is the Gotipuvas. These Gotipuvas are nothing but the young boys. Actually, they are disguised in the form of girls, and here they are trained in the Odissi dance. Next are the Maharis. Maharis are the temple dancers who came to be employed in the royal court, and that is how they tried to maintain the originality of the Odissi dance, and that is how it came forward. Now if you see, most of the famous Odissi dancers where would have been somewhere employed in the royal courts by the kings, and that is how they could carry the lineage of the Odissi dance. Coming to the Odissi dance, the importance is that torso movement becomes very, very important in the Odissi dance. So unlike the other dance forms where we saw either the beating of the legs becomes important, but here how you put up the torso, your torso becomes very, very important in the Odissi dance. Here if you see, basically torso moves from here, they try to keep the shoulders very, very straight as well as the hips, and then they try to swing the torso from one side of to the other along the axis of the body. And for this purpose there are two important postures or the techniques of movement which are usually built around two basic postures. Here as you can see, choke, right, it is called as chauk or choke. It shows the masculine, or you can call it as the Tandava form of dance, where usually you can see the body, how they have kept it in the square shape. And here, putting it as a square shape, they bend the torso in order to balance the body. Coming to the another important basic posture in the Odissi form is called as Tribhanga. This Tribhanga is again important because already it has been asked in the UPSC, right? So here in Tribhanga, you can see the feminine form. So you can call it as Lasya form of dance, where if you can see, neck, torso and the legs are all three are in the three different directions. So that is why it is called as Tribhanga, that means three different angles. Coming to the repertoire of the Odissi dance, it mainly consists of three phases of dance forms. First, it starts with the Mangalacharan. Here during the Mangalacharan, you can call it as an opening item. So just like Alari Puvu in Bharatanatyam, here the dancers enters with the flowers. Then after Mangalacharan, it enters into the second phase called as Bhatu, and here they perform the pure dance form called as Nrita, and here they perform the Nrita with the duality of performance. For some reason they will perform the chauk, and the next session they'll perform the Tribhanga. So it kind of shows both masculine as well as the Lasya form, that is feminine form. Then it enters the last phase called as Moksha, and in this Moksha as the last item, it is mainly based on the Abhinaya, which means the expressions. So here you can express the Nitya here. So coming to the musical instruments which are used in the Odissi dance, they make use of the pakavaj, singer, as well as the flutist, sitar or the violin, and the last one being the manjira. Coming to the next important dance form from the state of Assam, it is called as Satariya or Satriya. This dance form was introduced in the 15th century by the great Vaishnava poet or the saint called as Shankara Deva. And if we see the word Satriya or Satariya, it is derived from the Vaishnava maths. This Vaishnava maths were called as Satras. From there is where we get the words Satriyas. And the musical composition in the Satriyas are called as Bhargits. And the drums here are known as Kholes. The importance of the Satriya dance, it is very small but yet very elaborate, because this is performed strictly based on the principle which were laid down for Hastamudras. Here you can see how important are the Hastamudras for them, as well as it includes the footwork, and it gives equal importance to the jewelry as well as the makeup. So other than this, we do not have much to read in the Satriya. We do not get to see so much of repertoire for the Satriya. But whereas it only lays emphasis on the Hastamudras, footworks and the Aharyas like jewelry and makeup. Coming to the next important dance form called as Kathak. This is the only dance form of North India. And the word this Kathak, it is derived from the word called as Katha, which means the story. This present dance form saw its golden age under the patronage of Nawab Wajid Ali, who was the last Nawab of Awadh. And he is the one who established the Lucknow Gharana, which emphasizes on the expressions. Other than the Lucknow Gharana, we also have other two Gharanas, namely Jaipur, Raigarh, and the Banaras. And each Gharana emphasizes on different kind of aspects of the Kathak. If we have to talk about the Kathak as a basic gesture, we see that basic stance of this dance form is, as you can see in this picture, right? It is from where one hand is held at one level or the higher level of the head and other is held at the shoulder level. And this dance form, it is performed by both men and women, and it starts, the repertoire of this present dance form starts with the thought. This thought here means the soft movement of eyebrows and wrists. So they try to hear the dancer first try to move, gives an expression on the eyebrows called as Nritya, and then she tries to whirl the wrist in her hands. Then this start is followed by the Amat. Amat is nothing but a conventional entry of the dancer. Once the dancer enters the stage, then she performs the salami that you can see here in the picture, which is nothing but the salutation to the audience. That then she starts with the tukra. Tukra, which means the short piece of dance, and then it is followed by the toda, which is the long piece of dance. The most important aspect of this dance form is to whirl about. Just go through some video clip of the Kathak in order to get a proper idea, or you can even remember the Briju Maharaj. You can see a movie which was done by Kamala Hassan. I'm unable to recollect the movie name, but in order to know the exact form of this Kathak, this movie has shown a very beautiful aspects of this dance form. Coming to the most another important aspect of the Kathak is called as the Jugal Bandi. This is an important aspect. Here they try to show the interactive and the competitive play between the dancer and as well as the tabla player. Jugal Bandi here means mixing or the a chemistry between the two things. So here we see the chemistry of the dancer along with the tabla player, and here we get to see the competitive play where the dancer basically uses the fat feet, and she tries to control the sound of the ankle bells, which are usually worn by the dancer. So the important personalities in this includes the Briju Maharaj, Uma Sharma, and as well as the Sovana Narayanan. So the most important aspect of Kathak, because it has emerged as a distinct dance form, because this is the only classical dance form of India which have a links with the Muslim culture, and that is what it represents, a unique synthesis of Hindu as well as Muslim genesis in the heart. Kathak is the only form of dance, a classical dance, which is wedded to the Hindustani or the North Indian music, and both of them had a parallel growth, each feeding and sustaining the other. Coming to the last classical dance form of India called as Kathakali, and I hope it is very famous among all, right? But yet it is again the dance drama which belongs to the state of Kerala. There are two classical dances that are belonging to the state of Kerala, which includes the Kathakali as well as, just as we have seen, the Mohiniyattam. Now this Kathakali is considered to be the recent classical dance form, but yet we can see its evolution coming from the many art forms which were really ancient, which includes the Kodiyattam, Ramanattam, Krishnanattam, and Chakyar Kuthu. And it is also inducted to the martial arts of Kerala called as Kalairipattu. And this was a question in the UPSC prelims asking about the Kalairipattu. First, talking about the art forms from which this Kathakali has evolved. First, talking about the Chakyar Kuthu. Chakyar here, it is a word derived from a community name called as Chakyar, and Kuttu as in Tamil, here also Kuttu means the dance. And in this Chakyar Kuttu, the performer narrates the stories from the Hindu epics like Ramayana or the Mahabharata. Coming to the Krishnanatam, here you can get the word called as Krishna from here. So it is a temple art in Kerala and it is also a dance or drama form. Coming to the Ramanatam, as the name is again depicts, it is also based on the stories of Lord Rama. Coming to the Kodiyattam, very important one, it is a Sanskrit theatre performed in Kerala and officially this has been declared as the UNESCO as masterpiece of oral and the intangible heritage of humanity. If you remember, in the theatre classes we have also read about the Kodiyattam and the Ramanattam. So coming to the Kathakali, the main important form of Kathakali, which is a visual art form, is its costumes. This type of costume, such type of elaborate costumes, you cannot find in any of the classical dance forms. Not only costumes are important, but yet here makeup is done which is suited to the characters, and different characters are given different type of makeup. So with the makeup, each character is defined. So here they usually do, here you can see how they are doing a makeup to the Vellathadi. We will see what it is. So here the pacha or the green color in makeup is done, or it is dominated with the green color, especially for a noble character like Arjuna or the Indra. So for the noble characters, usually they do on the face, they give a green color. So with the color of the makeup, you can actually know which type of character they are going to do in the Kathakali. Coming to the Kathi, here usually they do it for this Kathi, it is done for the anti-hero characters, but yet they will be the great warriors. Example here you can take of Ravana, right? So among this them, how you can identify the Kathi characters is that they wear a small knob called as Chuttipu on the tip of the nose as well as on the forehead. So once you find such type of Chuttipu on the nose and forehead, you can actually identify them to be the anti-heroes, but yet the great warriors like the Ravana. Coming to the third one are the Tadi kind of makeup that you can see here, Vella Tadi, right? Vella here means white. So these are the Tadi, or the, like, you can remember it as a Dadi to the Hindi word, which means these are the beard characters. Important among them is the Vella Tadi, usually which tries to depict the Hanuma's character. Coming to the Kari, or you can think it as like Karpu or the black, right? So here the makeup base is mostly black, and hunters or the forest dwellers are usually done this Kari kind of makeup. Coming to the last kind of makeup artist that you can see here, usually they are called as Minakku, where the minor characters of women or stages are depicted with this type of Minakku. Coming to the repertoire of the Kathakali, or the sequence of the performance, if you see, first it starts with the announcement of the performance, which is called as Keli Kottu, right? Keli Kottu, it starts with Keli Kottu. Maybe you can remember this to the banana, where we call it as Kela. So it starts with the banana, which you can actually link it to the Kerala region, right? Next comes the Todayam. This Keli Kottu is followed by the Todayam. In Todayam, they try to introduce one or two characters, try to invoke the blessings of the god, right? Then comes the Purapadu, and in Purapadu, you can express the Nritta form of dance, where there will be a pure dance form among the Kathakali performers. Then it is followed by the Melapadu, where the musicians and drummers come onto the stage, and then at last, there will be a Tiranukku. Tiranukku means introduction of all characters onto the stage, but except the noble characters of Pacha and the women or stages, all the other characters are introduced onto the stage called as Thiranokku. So these were the important repertoires that you need to remember concerning the Kathakali. So don't get confused if you try to put some kind of clues or the, if you can give some 2 to 3 readings, this becomes important. Especially this type of questions are being asked in the UPSC. So you need to remember all these small words are being asked in the UPSC.